series, a two-part series, on the main rule of God for our life. This morning, I want to just begin with a highlight of last week, just to sort of bring us up to date. As a reminder, or those that were not able to be here last week, I shared seven foundational truths concerning the will of God. All right, so let's look at those. Number one, God's will for our life is to have a saved life. That's the revealed will of God. All those that believe upon Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior and receive Him personally, become a child of God, receive forgiveness of sins, and the gift of eternal life, and they're adopted into God's family. So that's where we begin with the will of God. And then we saw in second that God wants us to have a sacrificial life. Romans 12, that we're to give ourselves as a living sacrifice. That was language of the Old Testament, where they would then kill animals and put it on the altar of sacrifice and offer it up to God. But God wants us not to a dead sacrifice, a living sacrifice for those who have trusted Christ as their Lord and Savior. We're to give ourselves to the Lord as a believer without any reservation. And that is a process of time. Third, we've learned that these are all foundational, and every one of them has the will of God mentioned in the Scripture. It's God's will to have a Spirit-filled life. That once we're saved, the Holy Spirit of God, the third person of the Blessed Trinity, comes to live within us. Everyone here this morning who's a Christian, you have the Holy Spirit living in you. You're sealed with the Holy Spirit of God. And one thing I failed to say last week, so I'm kind of glad I'm overviewing, is that when I talk about the Holy Spirit, the fullness, it means the power, the control, the influence of the Holy Spirit upon our life. And I want you to understand something. When we're filled with the Holy Spirit, that doesn't mean we get more of the Holy Spirit. What it means is He gets more of us. It makes all the difference in the world. The more that we yield to Him, the more that He is in control and influence of our life. And then we saw that, number four, God's will is to have a sanctified life. Sanctified means set apart for God's purpose. That everyone here this morning, you're set apart for what? For God's purpose. God's purpose is to do His will, and that's what we're talking about. The will of God for our life. Number five, God's will is to have a surrendered life. And a surrendered life is one that, as this text says, give thanks in all things, for this is the will of God for your life. So we are to surrender. We're to give thanks in all circumstances. Notice the preposition, in, not for. Sometimes it's hard to give for things that happen, but in them, because we know that God will cause all things to work together for good, for those that love Him, who are called according to His purpose. And then, number six, that God's will is to have a submissive life. We are in submission to those authority structures that God has set up, and we see that in 1 Peter 2:13 through 17. And then God's will is for us to have a separated life, to be separated for His purpose, His glory, in 1 John 2:15 and 17. And one of the key words there is pride. We need to make certain that our life is not consumed with pride. Pride is the greatest enemy of the Christian life. Pride is what caused Satan to fall. He was an anointed sheriff, created by God in beauty and wisdom, Ezekiel 28. But he became full of himself, and to decided, why should God get all the worship? I need some. And influenced one third of the angelic beings to rebel with him, which I've never, ever understood. And I kept saying, how can that make sense? And finally I read G.C. Burkhauer, a theologian, who said something. I thought, boy, that answered it. He said, you can never give a rational explanation for an irrational act. And I said, that for him to do what he did makes absolutely no sense whatsoever. And how many times have people have found that when they've done something that just ruined their life, they're like, I can't even understand. I mean, what was I thinking? That was the problem, they weren't. So those are the seven foundations. And by the way, God can lead you as you're walking in these seven aspects of life. As I shared last week, when my wife and I were living in Nevada, after I retired 40 years at one church, I knew that they would call me for, we want you to be a funeral, want you to be a wedding, want you to fill in, want you. So I said, we need to get away. So for 2 years we were. But I was never, I was miserable. And she was too, in a sense of being separated from family and everything. But we were walking in these areas, and one day we were at the park, and God just laid on my heart, my spirit, time to go home. My wife, she can always tell, you know, when you're really close, we used to finish each other's sentences. We just had that close relationship. She said, what are you thinking about? And I said, well, I just sense God wants us to go back home. She said, praise God, he just told me that. And you see, we were just walking in the will of God, and God is moving and directing. But I know some of you are thinking, hey, that's wonderful. That's a great thought. But what, Pastor, what about those decisions like, should I buy this house? What about this job? I got two offers, which one? Because it doesn't say anywhere in the Bible exactly what house you're supposed to buy. It doesn't tell you who you're going to marry, what person you're going to marry. I'm going to say a little bit about that soon, if I help the young people. So let's talk about the second part of my message has to do with principle. Principle, what's a principle? A principle is a fundamental truth, a rule of right conduct. The Bible is full of principles for life. I'm going to share with you some principles that will help us in those areas, like should I marry this person? Pastor, should I take that job I've been offered? Or what about when we want to buy a home? And should we move and relocate? I believe, as I already said in the first part of the sermon, many times as we're walking in those areas of the will of God, he's at work in our life. But there are other times we need to have some understanding about certain things. So I'm going to give you some very simple practical steps that will help you in knowing the will of God and those things that are not clearly taught in Scripture. In fact, Ben asked me, we were in a meeting, and he said, how do you know what church you're supposed to be at? And I said, that's a good question. I'm going to answer that next Sunday. That's this Sunday. So let's consider some of those principles that can help us in those areas. But let me read two scriptures in the Old Testament. In Psalm 31, verse 3, the psalmist said, for you are my rock and my fortress, and for your name's sake, you lead me and guide me. For your name's sake, you lead me and you guide me. And then Psalm 32, verse 8. I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will counsel you with my eye upon you. So, understand that principles are not a formula, but they're biblical truths that can help our lives in decision making. So here's my first point. When you're wanting to know the will of God for your life, you're walking in those foundational truths that I talked about. Number one, have I prayed about it and asked God for wisdom? See, I'm going to be very practical. Have I prayed about it? And have I asked God for wisdom? All of us know the Bible emphasizes, one thing I never get any objection with on Christians is the importance of prayer. Amen?
Amen.
Everybody believes it. If you're a Christian and you believe in prayer, prayer is our communion, our talk and walk with God. It's talking with God. And by the way, you can just talk to Him in a very conversational way. Prayer is important. 1 Thessalonians 5:17, pray without ceasing, or pray at all times. Luke 18:1, Jesus told them a parable to the effect that we ought always to pray and not lose heart. We're to pray and not lose heart. Psalm 55:16-17, I'll call on the Lord and the Lord will save me. Evening and morning and at noon, I utter my complaint and moan, and He hears my voice. God hears our voice. God delights when we pray and seek Him. 1 Peter 3:12, the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and His ears are open to their prayer, but the face of the Lord is against those that do evil. God is ready at all times, any time, for us to begin to seek Him in prayer and communion with Him as we seek direction for our life. Listen to Philippians 4:6-7. Do not be anxious about anything. Wow, that's an amazing truth for today. But in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. In everything, pray. See, Christians ought to be people of prayer. They need to have it, not just on the Lord's Day. We should pray, certainly on the Lord's Day. But we need to pray throughout the week, throughout the day, throughout life. As we come to those decisions that we need to make, and we want guidance, the greatest thing to do is start praying and seeking God. Prayer is so powerful. And I read this little book called Elijah by Howard Hendricks. He taught at Dallas Theological Seminary. And he was a great teacher in education. And he wrote this little book. And this was so unique, I wanted to just read it to you right out of the book, because it the way he stated it. He said, shortly after the seminary, this is Dallas Theological Seminary, Dallas, Texas. Shortly after the seminary was founded in 1924, it almost capitulated, almost went bankrupt. It came to that point of bankruptcy. All the creditors were going to foreclose at 12 noon on a particular day. That morning, the founders of the school met in the president's office to pray that God would provide. You see, when you're in a crisis, there's nothing better than seeking God immediately. And in the prayer meeting was Harry Ironside. Harry Ironside was a preacher. And when it was his turn to pray, he prayed in his characteristically refreshing manner. And here's what he prayed. Lord, we know that the cattle on a thousand hills are thine. please sell some of them and send us the money. While they were praying, a tall Texan with boots on and open collar came into the business office and said, I just sold 2 carloads of cattle in Fort Worth. I've been trying to make a business deal go through and it won't work, and I feel God compelling me to give this money to the seminary. I don't know if you need it or not, but here's the check. A little secretary took the check, knowing something of the criticalness of the hour financially, went to the door of the prayer meeting and timidly tapped on it. When she finally got the response of Dr. Schaefer, he took the check out of her hand, and it was the exact amount they needed. When he looked at the signature on the check, he recognized the name of the cattleman from Fort Worth. Turning to Dr. Ironside, he said, Harry, God sold the cattle. You see, that just shows you the power of prayer. You know, now it doesn't always happen that fast, but they needed it to happen that fast. But God hears our prayers. So when you're seeking the will of God in something that may not be clearly stated in Scripture, then start praying. And you should pray not only to God, but you should pray for wisdom. Listen to what James 1 says. If any lacks wisdom, let him ask God, who gives generously to all without reproach, and it will be given to him. What is wisdom? It's the ability to make good decisions. It's God's wisdom so that we can make good decisions. So, when you're considering something in your life that's not clear-cut in Scripture, begin to seek God in prayer. Okay? That's number one. Number two, is it consistent with Scripture? And will it be a positive witness for Christ? Whatever decision you're confronted with and you need to make, and you're beginning to pray for God to give you direction and wisdom, consider this. Is it consistent with the Scripture? And will it be a positive witness for Christ? Psalm 119:16, I will delight in your statutes. I will not forget your word. Psalm 119:89, forever, O Lord, your word is firmly fixed in the heavens. Psalm 119:105, your word is a lamp to my feet and it's a light to my path. The word of God is our guide for life. By the principles. You see, it may not be a direct statement on buying this house or taking this job or whatever, but it gives you principles for living that will help you in making decisions. Psalm 119:147, I rise before dawn and I cry for help. I hope in your words. God says, call on me. Jesus said in John 17:17, sanctify them in truth. Your word is truth. 2 Timothy 3:16-17. All Scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be competent and equipped for every good work. So when we know the Word of God, when we get the Word of God in our spirit and in our heart and our soul, when we meditate upon it, when we pray and we seek decision, then we know a decision that is consistent with God's Word and His principles. You know, I can't say it enough. The more that we know God's Word, the wiser we are in decision making. We all know that when Jesus was tempted by Satan, remember he said, after 40 years of fasting and prayer, he said, why don't you take the stone and turn it into food? Jesus quoted Deuteronomy 8:3, we do not live by bread alone. Now watch this. Every time Satan came against Jesus, he quoted the scripture. Why? Because he knew the scripture. He had saturated his life with the truth. Yeah, he was truly God, but he was man. He acted as man, dependent upon the Father and the Holy Spirit. And then Satan said, you know, why don't you just jump off the pinnacle and the angels will have charge and they'll catch you. And Jesus quoted again, Deuteronomy. Something interesting, when he quoted three times, we're going to see out of Deuteronomy, that means it looks pretty interesting. He said Deuteronomy 6:16, do not tempt God. Don't tempt God. Once I was with a preacher friend when I was in Fort Worth, Texas, and we were in a hospital making a visit, and I saw him, he saw me, and he wanted me to go in and visit with him a couple that was in intensive care. I had prayer with him. I said, okay. And it had a sign on there, put on mask, gloves, and a schmuck. And he said, oh, we don't need to do that, let's go in. I said, whoa, just a minute. I said, they've asked us to do that, we should do that. And second, it's probably something contagious, or we don't want to get them sick. And so we need to do that because I don't want to tempt God. Amen. Yeah, you're right. And so we dressed appropriately, went in, had prayer, and left. And his thought was, thank you for reminding me. We're not here to tempt God. We shouldn't be foolish about our actions. And then he said, why don't you just worship me, and I'll give you all the kingdoms of the world. And Jesus quoted Deuteronomy 6:13-14, worship God alone. Worship God alone. Here's the point. Everything Satan came against him, he quoted the Word of God. He was consistent with Scripture, and he was a tremendous witness for us how important the Word of God is in our life. So that we have in Scripture principles, commandments, examples, and stories. Now, let me, you know, young people, as they get out of high school, whatever they do, go to the military, get a job, go to work, go to college, whatever they do, eventually they come to that place of marriage. Maybe as they're getting out of high school, whatever it may be. And they always say, Pastor, how do you know that this person is the right person to marry? And I said, thank you for asking that question. Let's consider that. I'm going to give three principles, young people, that will help you. Three principles. You know, one day you're going to come to that time of your life where you're going to get married. Well, number one principle, you ought to know what I'm going to say, but I'm going to say it anyway. Do not marry a non-Christian. Amen? Amen. That's foundational. Don't give me this up. Well, Pastor, I'm going to marry him or her, and then I'm going to need Christ. You don't know if that will ever happen or not. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 6:14, do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers. What is partnership with, what does righteousness have to do with lawlessness? And listen, even in 1 Corinthians 7:39, Paul wrote, a wife is bound to her husband as long as he lives, but if the husband dies, she's free to marry to whom she wishes, only in the Lord. Only in the Lord. So number one, young people, you marry a Christian. Now, let me say something to the girls. They have the power of influence. You know, if you start meeting someone and things are going well and he's not a Christian, you know what you can say? I guarantee you this will work. If he likes you, you say, I just want you to know I'm a Christian. and I can't bear a Christian, so if you'll come to church with me and consider being Christian, we'll talk about dating. He'll say, I'll get there someday. I guarantee you. Guarantee it. It'll work. You've got to marry a Christian. Number two. By the way, my wife and I were married 48 years, 6 months before she had a stroke and went to be with the Lord. We followed these three principles and they worked. Number two, you want to have parental blessing. The fifth commandment, honor your father and mother that your days may be long in the earth. Ephesians tells us in chapter 6, children, obey your parents in the Lord. This is right. Honor your father and mother. It's the first commandment with a promise that it may go well with you and you may live long in the earth. There's something about our parents. Now, I realize we live in a time where you may only be living with your mother, or you may only be living with your father. There might have been a divorce, it might have been a death, all kinds of factors. But the parent's blessing is an amazing thing. My wife, Benita, that's with a V. Everybody calls her Benita. No, it's Benita. Benita. My mother loved her. I lived with my mother. I shared with you that my mom and dad were divorced when I was just 2 years old. And she never married until after all the kids got out of the home. There were six kids. You know, she'd bring somebody home. We'd go, hi. And he'd say, bye. She loved Benita. And her parents, Benita's parents, were a member of the Baptist Church, and they loved me. And I asked her father her hand. I said, I'd like to marry your daughter, and I'd like your blessing. He said, you have it 100%. Marry a Christian, get parental blessing, and then third, that you share your purpose of life together. Now, if you're two Christians, you love the Lord, you're saved. One of your purposes is to live and worship Jesus Christ and to bring up your children with admonition and the nurture of the Lord. And so you have a purpose. I was called to preach. And I shared that, and soon after Benita and I started dating, she already knew I was called to preach. And she told me later that God spoke to her heart and said, I want you, you're to be a pastor's wife. And so we had that bond together. We shared, and she was an incredible pastor's wife. What a blessing she was to my life. So those three points, young people. Date a Christian. You see, the reason you don't want to date a non-Christian is you'll fall in love and then start making all kinds of excuses. Well, I'm going to win that person after. They don't want to be a Christian, but they'll get, you know, blah, blah, blah. So you date a Christian, and then in that time comes you want to marry, you get your parents' blessing, and then you share together. Our life will be centered in Jesus Christ. Amen? Follow those, and you will be blessed. And by the way, since my wife's been in heaven 7 years, I've been praying, God has led me. I'm now dating a lady. And God's so good. She grew up in my home church. She's Southern Baptist. I mean, everything about is so good. And already my parents are no longer living. I mean, I'm in my 70s. By then I make the decision, but her mother is 96. She takes her, and already she loves me. Her mother, my daughter does. My kids love her. So everything's just going good. We're already right in that line with what God's doing. She's a Christian. I'm a Christian. We got the family's blessing on both sides. And we both are in agreement that we serve Christ and live for Him. God is good. All the time. Number three, will God be glorified in my attitude and my actions? In all that I'm going to do. Glory means great honor, admonition, admiration, and splendor. Listen, here's a scripture that all of us need to live by. 1 Corinthians 10:31. I should have had it put up on the screen, but I forgot to write it down. So I'll just read it. And here's what it says. So whether you eat or drink, or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. What is scripture to live by? This is a scripture that we need to live by. Whatever we do, do it all to the glory of God. What is our attitude? Our attitude is so important. Our attitude is our outlook on life. It's your mental and emotional outlook that is expressed in body posture, your attitude. It's amazing how our attitude comes through our body expression. I mean, I can go home and walk in the door of the neighbor and say, what's wrong? I said, I didn't tell you anything was wrong. She said, you don't have to. I can see it in you. What's the problem? You know, our attitude is so important. Our actions, do whatever we do, we are to do to the glory of God. You know, Billy Graham, one of the greatest preachers, he preached, I think I'm correct in this, in his lifetime to over 40 million people. Now maybe that's a little high. I don't remember what it was, but I mean, he would have crusades after crusades all over the world. And this man had such an attitude of humility. When, he would do this. If he was sitting down in a room and an older man walked in, he stood up. You know why? Because it says in Leviticus 19:32, you shall stand up before the gray head and the face of an old man, and you shall fear the Lord your God. I am the Lord. His attitude was so humble that when he's in a room and an older man walked in, he stood up in respect toward that person. Wow. Here's a man that was known all over the world. The name Billy Graham. Because of his attitude and his actions in life, God so blessed him. Number four, am I acting responsibly and with reason? Am I acting responsibly? We hear that all the time. Act responsible. How come you're not? Well, we live in a world of irresponsible people. Irresponsible people today. They don't have responsibility and neither act with reason. Irresponsible action never, ever honors God. You know, another thing is that God has given us a mind, and sometimes we fail to understand. He actually wants us to use it between our ears. It's called a mind, a brain. We're supposed to act with reason. Listen to what it says in Isaiah 1:18. Come now, let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are red like crimson, they shall be like wool. What was it that the Pharisee, who is a lawyer, asked Jesus? He asked him, what is the greatest commandment? And you know what he said, Matthew 22:34-38. He said, the greatest commandment is to love God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, and with all of your mind. So he wants us to use our mind. He wants us to use reason. That God will work in a special way. And when we get wisdom, that gives us reason. So, if you want to buy a home, and you've gone through your budget, and you say, I can pay $500 a month maximum. I can buy this home, and if I spend $500 a month, I'll be okay. Or whatever it is. And you find a home and you just fall in love with it, and they tell you to figure everything out, and the payment will be $1,200 a month. What do you think you ought to do? You know what some people will do? They'll try to justify and rationalize everything they can. They buy the home, it overwhelms them, they get deeper in debt, they argue and fight and fuss and everything. Why? Because they didn't use just common sense, wisdom, and reason. I've said this before, and I believe it. We're living in a time in America where common sense is gone. Just common sense is gone. I mean, I'm simple. I've said this before. I'm going to say it again. I want you to know, you already know this. I'm a man. By the way, I'm male. I can tell you one thing I can't become. I cannot become a woman. That's the craziest nonsense, stupid nonsense I've ever heard on planet Earth. And yet they're promoting that everywhere. Do you know that a man was fired in a college who taught biology and said that your DNA determines your gender, and they fired him? That's how nutty crazy our country is getting. We've lost our mind. The farther you get away from God, the stupider you can become.
Amen.
Thank you. Amen. I mean, we live in a world where the reason is just gone. It makes no sense. You know, God's given us reason. Now, I understand that even with reason, there are things that God can do that are supernatural, that are beyond reason. But we need, when God gives a clear direction, you do it. I mean, you know, Joshua was told to march around Jericho 6 days one time, and then on the seven times. And then they were to shout. Now, it's like, and he said, I'm going to bring the walls down. You know, like, okay. Well, the difference there is God clearly, directly told them what to do and what he was going to do. So they marched around, blew the trumpets, down went the walls. It's, you know, and so I'm not saying that everything has to be rational, reasonable, and there are things that God can do supernaturally. When I got cancer, I remember praying, God, you're sovereign, you're Lord, you split the Red Sea. You can heal directly if you choose to. He also works indirectly through doctors, medicine, hospitals. And I prayed, I was doing this, praying these thoughts, and in my heart it was very clear, God said, I'm going to heal you, but it's going to be through secondary means. You're going to go through the treatments. So I had 25 radiation treatments, and then I had surgical treatment. But I had to work through God, and I had just a peace about those. I never knew what it's actually, you know, when you go to lay on the thing and take radiation, you're not knowing what's happening next. This big machine coming flying over your back. I went to the doc, my cancer doctor, last week. Here's what he said. They follow up 5 years after the treatment. He said, Pat, you, my friend, are 100% cured. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. He said, you're cured. Completely, 100%. And I said, thank you. And after I had gone through those treatments, I had a friend, Jerry, who called me and said, Pastor, I got the same cancer you do. And I said, well, here's what you do. And I told him every step of the way, how it was going to happen and all that. See, God uses that to comfort others and help them. And he went through the same treatment I did. And he called me and he said, I want to thank you. What you shared with me so helped me to go through all that. And I praise you the name of Jesus. Well, let's move on. We got the Lord. Number five. We got 7 points. So, number five, have I received counsel from spiritually mature believers? When you're making a major decision, you can be in your 20s or your 30s or your 40s or whatever, particularly when you're younger. Find men and women who walk with God many years and get counsel.
Amen.
Listen what it says in Proverbs 12:15. The way of a fool is right in his own eyes. The wise man listens to counsel, our advice. Proverbs 15:22, without counsel, plans fail, but with many counselors, they succeed. Proverbs 19:20, listen to advice and accept instruction that you may gain wisdom in the future. You see, people who've walked with God many years have been seasoned in life, and they have some wisdom in helping us make decisions. Remember Rehoboam's folly? If you don't, I'll tell you about it. In 931, Israel split. 930, Solomon died, and Rehoboam took over. And listen what it says in 1 Kings 12. Rehoboam went to Shechem, and all Israel came to Shechem to make him king. And as soon as Jeroboam, son of Nebat, heard of it, he was still in Egypt, where he fled from King Solomon. Then Jeroboam returned from Egypt. And they sent and called him, and Jeroboam and all the assembly of Israel came and said to Rehoboam, your father made our yoke heavy. Now therefore lighten the hard service of your father and his heavy yoke on us, and we'll serve you. He said to them, go away for 3 days and come again. Now, so they went away, and King Rehoboam went to get counsel of the older men. This is what it said. King Rehoboam took counsel from the old men who stood before Solomon, his father, while he was yet alive, saying, how do you advise me to answer the people? And they said, if you will be a servant to the people today, serve them and speak good words to them. When you answer them, then they will be your servants forever. But he abandoned the counsel that the old man gave him and took counsel from the young men who had grown up with him and stood with him. And the young men said, thus shall you speak to the people. Your father made our yoke heavy, but you lightened it for us. Thus you shall say, my little finger is thicker than my father's thigh. And now whereas my father laid on a heavy yoke, I will add to your yoke. My father disciplined you with whips, I'll discipline you with scorpions. That was a young, and I'm not picking on young, but the older people had been seasoned and said, be a servant, be kind. Young ones said, whips not out of them. You know, let them know who's in control. So they came back, and that's what he said, and they said, let's leave, everyone. 10 tribes left, the 12 went up north. And then 2 tribes in the south. Why? Because he got bad counsel. There are some godly men and women who have walked with the Lord many, many years, and they can give you help in understanding things like this. Number 6, do I have a sanctified desire and peace about my decision? Delight yourself in the Lord, Psalm 37:4, and he'll give you the desires of your heart. The more that we delight ourselves in the Lord, the more that he will give us a peace about our hearts and about that decision we have to make. Let me say something. When you're making a decision and you're just, you can't get peace about it. You just feel, oh man, you keep working at it. That could be a good indication that decision is not the right one. You know, people say this. They say, we were going to buy this home, and we just got overwhelmed with anxiety about it, and something was wrong. And I said, that could be God's way of trying to say, stop, don't go there. And I've heard many examples of those. Then there's the times where you just have an absolute peace. It's so free. It's so light. You see, here's what Jesus said, John 14:27. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. And when we have the peace of God flooding our soul in decision making, that's God giving his leadership. As I was asked, how do I know that a church is right? You know, I pastored one church for 40 years. Every church I went to, I followed these steps. And God gave me peace, and I knew it was right to be in that church. When you contacted me, Bob contacted me, said, "Are you available?" By text. I was glad it was text. I've learned how to do that on the phone. And then we began to talk. And then I came, and I just had a complete peace. This is where God wants me to be in from pastor. You know, I didn't even know you guys existed. I never heard of New Haven. I didn't know there was a New Haven or a Memorial Baptist. But guess who does know? God. And God's at work. So when you take those foundational truths and these principles, God, wow, it just is great. Now, number one, my last point. Number seven. Has God opened the doors of opportunity and do I truly sense the leadership of the Holy Spirit? Has God opened doors? You see, the Bible teaches that. God opens doors and God closes doors. It's going to happen. Sometimes it just shuts and you go, oh, what happened? Be grateful. Sometimes we don't realize. I remember a story of a little girl who's screaming, crying, and the mother said to her husband, What's wrong? Why is she crying so much? He said, I couldn't let her get what she wanted. Well, what did she want? She wanted to catch a bumblebee. You know? The point is, sometimes we don't realize how God can shut doors because we might have grabbed a bumblebee. You see, 1 Corinthians 16:8-9, Paul said, but I stayed in Ephesus until Pentecost, for a wide door for effective work is open to me, and there are many adversaries. Listen to 2 Corinthians 2:12. When I come to Troas, preach the gospel of Christ, even though a door was open for me, for a door was opened to me by the Lord. Colossians 4:3, at the same time pray also for us that God may open to us a door to declare the mysteries of God. God will open doors and God can close doors. Now I know the search committee just had two men that were right at the top, convinced they were doing it. One of them might take it, and they both dropped out. They both closed the door. The door closed. Don't get a crowbar, try to open it. You just accept it. God closed that door. Somebody else is coming. Somebody else will be available. And it might be later that door might open. I mean, God works in unique ways. Let me tell you how I learned this principle. This was so cool. When I was in college, my senior year in college, and I'm actually coming to the close, and then we'll have invitation and then Lord's Supper. I was in college, and I was taking Spanish. At one time, I was thinking maybe God wants me to be a missionary to South America, so I was taking Spanish. And I was going to go to seminary, and I boiled it down to two seminaries. Southwestern Seminary in Fort Worth, Texas. Southern Seminary in Louisville, Kentucky. My pastor, Jim Doon, at Meadow Heights, went to Southwestern. He was pushing Southwestern, yes. Keith Stanford, a pastor friend of mine, he went to Louisville Southern. He was pushing Southern. So I said, okay. I couldn't go all the way to Texas, but Keith Stanford said, I'll take you to Louisville, give you the tour, and then you can check all that. I said, okay. When are we going? He said, let's leave next Friday. I said, okay. So I went to my Spanish teacher, and I said, I'm going to have to miss next Friday if that's okay. He said, no, we have a midterm exam, and you will be there, and if you're not, you get an F. Well, he had no mercy. I said, okay. So I went back, and I told Keith, I said, I'm sorry, I can't go. My professor said we're having our midterm, and it's Friday, the day we were going to leave. And he said, well, maybe we can schedule it at another time. Do you know, I walked in that Friday. The professor came in. He said, something's happened. We're not going to have a test today. And I thought, you rotten. I thought, what? I was so upset. And I was so mad when I settled down. God said, hey, in my heart. Do you realize that I closed that door so you'd go to Southwestern Seminary? Do you know what I didn't know? This was 60 years ago, way back there. At that time, Louisville had gone, the seminary had gone liberal. I didn't know that. God did. Southwestern was still conservative. God blocked that door. By the way, Southern is now conservative. They got a new man, and it's conservative. But at that time, it was liberal. God closed the door. And when I went to Southwestern, and they taught the conservative truth of Scripture, I said, thank you, God, for your leadership in my life. Okay? Now, I want you to know that, in closing, that it's not always easy to know the will of God. You have to pursue it. Sometimes He doesn't give the answer because He wants you to pursue it, and work and pray and seek His face and read Scripture and get counsel. And then one day it'll come. All different aspects. Even Paul had that problem. I close with this. Knowing the will of God is not always easy. It said in Acts 16:6-12, and they went through the region of Phrygia and Galatia, having been forbidden by the Holy Spirit to speak the word in Asia. Paul started to go to Asia, and God said, no, you can't go that way. And when he had come to Mysia, they attempted to go to Bithynia, but the Spirit of Jesus didn't allow him. Started to go to Bithynia. God said, no. He was closing doors. And Paul's like, and he said, so passing by Mysia, they went down to Troas, and a vision appeared to Paul in the night. A man of Macedonia was standing there urging and saying, come over to Macedonia and help us. When Paul had seen the vision, immediately we sought to go on into Macedonia, concluding that God had called us to preach there. He said no to Asia. He said no to Bithynia. He said yes to Macedonia. But Paul was seeking and had to keep going until God finally led him. You see, sometimes when we struggle through it, it matures us and it grows us. So, there we are. And I finally, my last statement of closing is, guide me, O thou great Jehovah. Oh, I wish I could sing, but I'm going to read it. Guide me, O thou great Jehovah, pilgrim through this barren land. I am weak, but thou art mighty. Hold me with thy powerful hand. Bread of heaven, feed me till I want no more. Feed me till I want no more. Open now thy crystal fountain, whence the healing stream doth flow. Let the fire and cloud pillar lead me all my journey through. Strong deliverer, be thou my strength and shield. Be thou my strength and shield. When I tread the verge of Jordan, bidding my anxious fears subside, bear me through the swelling current, land me safe on Canaan's side. Songs of praise, I will ever give to thee. Guide me, O thou great Jehovah. Everybody, would you stand with your heads bowed and your eyes closed?